What's going on, guys? Coming at you today with a new video. It's been a little while since I made a video on this channel, and I think what I have to do is just lower my standards a little bit for the videos I post on this channel, because I have all these like grand ideas, and if it doesn't live up to what I'm anticipating it being, I just don't post it. So, you know, just more free-flowing, these are my thoughts type of stuff. It doesn't have to be some like grand plan that I put together. So today, I just wanted to talk about sort of a year in review, year preview for the markets. Mainly, I guess, the stock market, but also the real estate market, just like how I'm thinking about things, because we're really at some sort of crazy inflection point right now. I mean, like the idea that the stock market and the real estate market close the year close to where they start the year, to me, seems like the least likely outcome. Like it's going to be much higher or much lower. I think we're just in a period of like maximal volatility right now. So I just want to go over some things I'm kind of watching. Of course, guys, this is not investment advice. This is just how I think about things. Some idiot on YouTube who doesn't know what he's talking about. Something that is definitely going on is people are sitting at home and they want to gamble. So they're using the stock market, Robinhood apps, crypto, even sports betting to do that. So for example, right now I'm making this video in the midst of, you know, GameStop going nuts. There's obviously not too many parallels to this. Like this is not something that happens every day. So this is GameStop, you know, trading at $4 a couple months ago. It is now trading at close to 400, almost touched 400. It's fueled by Wall Street Bets, which is a Reddit subreddit, which is just people making what they call YOLO bets on different stocks and stuff, using the stock market to gamble explicitly, though. They're aware that they're doing it, which, you know, you got to applaud them for that. GameStop was a heavily shorted stock, which has now just exploded in value. It is a hilariously, it is now, I don't know if you guys can see this, it's a $25 billion company right now. A few months ago, it was less than a billion. 2008 Volkswagen, which was apparently known as the Infinity short squeeze, right here. Volkswagen briefly became the most valuable company on Earth, which is pretty crazy. This happened in 2008. I don't know that you can draw conclusions to the fact that this happened 2008, which was another period of extreme market turmoil. I wouldn't necessarily draw that comparison, but man, it's hard. So here's some things I'm struggling with right now. It definitely seems like we're in some sort of crazy bubble, right? The stock market completely disconnected from economic reality. It also seems like we're in a bubble of people thinking we're in a bubble, which to me is usually not the case when you're actually in a bubble. And I've done some digging on this topic, actually, and I think that's incorrect. So I was looking back at some like 2000.com bubble era writings like Howard Marks. There's actually a really good podcast. He reads his memos. Howard Marks is like a, you know, a really famous, successful investor for like 40 years now. And he's famous for calling the dot-com bubble basically like right as it popped, a little before it popped. When I remember the dot-com bubble, I think of it through the lens of like my life and my family, who was, you know, my dad just worked for Ford Motor Company. My uncle was a doctor, and they became stock market pickers and stock market geniuses. And some of my aunts and uncles became day traders. Very reminiscent of sort of some things I'm seeing going on today in the market today. But that's the lens I view it through. So when the dot-com bubble popped, to me, it was like, whoa, no one saw this coming. This is crazy. I can totally see how people thought the internet was, you know, the future. This time it's different. These companies are totally different from any companies we've seen before. You got to get in now. They only go up. That was my perspective. And looking back on it and doing a little bit more reading and research, that wasn't the actual perspective of Wall Street. A lot of people, and some prevailing narrative I've heard lately is like, when bubbles happen, maybe 2008 was different because it was sort of just like an isolated housing crisis that spilled over into other things. But just like pure valuation bubbles, like 2000.com bubble, everyone is in on it. Everyone knows what's going on, but there's so much money to be made in the short term that you sort of try riding it to the top, and it's worth the risk reward to maybe you get out a little late and you lose some money, but there's so much money to be made in the run up. So that's a little bit of a different perspective. Prior to doing this research, I always thought stock market bubbles just sort of came out of nowhere. Everyone was like, oh man, this is new technology. It's going to the moon. and then out of nowhere, the market crashes. That doesn't seem to be the case. Some things I am following, though, is just social indicators, you know, throughout my own life, maybe on social media and stuff. I put a decent amount of value in those because they seem to be true. You want to be introspective and try to, although you can't really, the whole thing with market psychology is you can't really like outsmart it. So, but what I do like to think of is like, hey, I'm starting a, you know, like a financial business stock market type of YouTube channel. Why would I be doing that now? That sort of says something about where we are, right? We're probably not near the bottom. There's not a lot of people starting new stock market channels near the bottom of the market. We're probably somewhere near the top. I didn't realize that, but back in 2000, if I was reliving that, I was a kid back then. I was like 12, I think, or yeah, I was 12. The fact that my uncle is telling me about Qualcomm and that I have to buy stock, or he wasn't telling me, but he was telling my parents, that's a red flag, obviously. I know that now. I didn't know that back then. So the fact, you can't make this stuff up, that while I was on my walk today, my college basketball teammate texted me and asked me what stocks I'm buying. And we've talked a little bit about business, mostly like about real estate in the past. And he's somewhat business minded. But I was like, I responded, I was like, I don't know, I'm a little nervous about the market right now. I'm not investing too heavily. I don't like to give unsolicited advice because if you think something and then I change your mind and I'm wrong, you're right. I don't want to, you know, deal with that. So like, if you think the market's going up, keep on investing. So I was just like, yeah, I'm not really getting involved too much, a little nervous about what's going on right now. And he hits me with a list of stocks he's been buying heavily. You guys know what they are, of course. Let me just grab the exact text message here. Blink Charging, Plug Power, and Workhorse. All EV related stocks, electric vehicles. So that to me, definitely a warning sign, definitely a red flag. Like, would I ever be investing in electric vehicle stocks right now? No. You know, so we look at like, I guess, Plug Power. Here is like the last, let's do weekly. So here's what Plug Power has been doing, you know, just really exponential parabolic rise. So do I want to be buying in anywhere around here? No, that's not how I invest in stocks. I invest mostly, I fancy myself a fundamental sort of value investor. I don't really play momentum, which you can do really good. It seems like if you just play the momentum, when you see it start rising, you invest, and when it starts dropping, you sell. I think that's easier said than done, but it's definitely been working lately. But it makes me nervous. This is not any kind of chart I would look at and be like, oh, gotta get in. I'm like, this is gonna end. Like, you rarely see a chart, right, that goes up like this and then stabilizes and slowly starts increasing. The only chart that follows something like this is exactly like this. So the thing is, it could go up, you know, there's no reason it can't double or quadruple or 10x from here, but eventually we're getting back down here. And I'm more of a long-term time horizon investor. I like to just buy things that I can hold on to for 5 to 10 years. This doesn't seem to be it. Although I will say, if you look, there was an EV rush in the early 2000s as well. So, I mean, you could have been accumulating stock when no one was really talking about EV, electric vehicles, and, you know, done really well for yourself. Same thing happens with Bitcoin. So, like, to me, if you are really interested in these stocks, there's going to come another buying opportunity. Maybe do your research now and be looking at a point where you can accumulate more in the future. I think you always want to be somewhat optimistic. It's really hard for me lately. Even since, like, 2017, I've been sort of a market pessimist. I'm like, things are going to come crashing down at any minute here. I'm nervous. And obviously, if you had that perspective in 2017, you would have missed out on a huge run up in stocks. So here's Bitcoin. We're sort of on the decline here with Bitcoin. This is the weekly chart. Here's daily. We touched 42,000 at a high, and now it's touched a little below 30,000 a couple times now. And I'm just in holding mode with Bitcoin. I mean, I'm never really a seller, although there is a point at which I would sell some. I'm sort of like a never sell for a percentage of my Bitcoin. Like, probably 50% of the Bitcoin I have now is just never sell. But there is a point at which I would start selling incrementally. We haven't touched that yet. I think probably maybe 50K plus is when I'd start entertaining selling some. The thing is what do you sell for? Like, you want more US dollars? That's sort of the tough thing to because I want less US dollars, right? I want as much assets as I can get, and I don't want to be holding US dollars, really. That's sort of the whole sentiment of the market. You can see, so the dollar obviously losing value dramatically. It's tough to predict these things, but just with the amount of money we're printing, it's hard for me to imagine the dollar really being really appreciating too much in the near future. I'm more of the mindset that we're going to be stimulating the economy, printing more money more frequently forever. So I want less dollars if at all possible. I want to buy stocks. I want to buy real estate. I want to buy Bitcoin. I want to buy gold. Just things that hold value relative to the dollar. But the market has already priced a lot of this in. So with the dollars I do have right now, I'm sort of just in wait and see mode. I would prefer not to have them, but I've already, in my mind, missed the boat a little bit. Like, the market's run up so much. The real estate market's run up a lot. The Bitcoin, just basically everything except fiat currencies have gone up a lot. And that, to me, is because of the anticipation of more money printing and just stimulus in the future, debasing the currency. So, for example, last year I bought two houses that I'm renting. The first house I bought in May for $224,000. And it's currently valued at $285,000. So that's an appreciation in 7 months of 22%. I mean, I got a pretty good deal on it, so I'm not going to say that's pure appreciation, but say 15% of that is just real estate appreciation. So that's asset inflation. The dollar is being debased, so the assets are worth more. My other house I bought in August for $324,500, and it's now valued at $414,000. So that, again, in only 6 months, is a 22% appreciation. Maybe 15 to 17% of that was pure appreciation, where the rest of it was just getting a good deal. But I mean, there has to be some diminishing returns. That's sort of how the market moves, right? So like, if real estate appreciated 22% in 2020, it's not just going to appreciate another 22%. There's going to be some ebbs and flows of it. The dynamic, at least for me, and I think a lot of people are feeling this, is like, what do I do with my fiat money? Where do I put it? Because I don't want to just hold on to it because the government's printing so much of it. I want to buy cash producing assets, but the assets cost so much right now relative to the dollar that doesn't make sense. It's sort of a tough situation to be in. So what I'm kind of waiting for right now is a little bit of a rebound in the dollar relative to assets so that the asset prices drop. Because to me, the run up in the stock market, the run up in real estate, it's pricing in a lot of downside with fiat currency in the future. So maybe there's a little bit of a rebound effect where you can put some money to work and buy some cash producing assets. Although I think a lot of people are waiting for that opportunity, so I don't know if it will ever really come. Back to the stock market then. What you'll notice is retail participation. So for example, the stuff that's happening with GameStop. Just the fact that there's so many people trading on Robinhood. The fact that my friend is texting me about EV stocks. The increase in the height of retail participation, which is just like non-Wall Street, non-hedge funds, just like mom and pops buying stocks, that goes up the most at a peak, a market peak. So, I mean, my thinking is we're at a market peak. You don't want to have like really strong convictions and strong predictions when you're dealing with this. You want to play probabilities. So I think a good term is like strong convictions loosely held, or strong opinions loosely held. So my strong opinion that I'm holding loosely right now is when things start getting back to normal, lockdowns and everything, people are getting out and about, spending more money, just, you know, moving freely about society, that is actually going to end a start of a bubble pop to some extent. It might not be like a huge crash. I'm expecting more people working, less people just thinking of ways they can gamble, stocks, you know, all this type of stuff. That'll end a little bit. And then one other thing I've been watching is this, guys, money supply. So it's hard to see. Can you see those little dots? I think you can. Can I change this line? Yeah, there we go. Okay, so money supply. This is going back, let's go back to like 1990, the money supply. 2008, this is the quantitative easing. We're printing more money. There's more money supply steadily increasing for the last like 12 years. And then this is March 2020. Crazy dramatic increase. That is a 40% increase over the course of 6 months. So that is the money supply. So when there's more money, obviously your existing money in your bank account becomes less valuable, right? Supply and demand, the basics. So if we, the reason that this hasn't actually been manifesting is the velocity of money right here. You will see this is how much money moves around in the economy, where like transactions, you know, just money moving around. These are the two components of inflation. So money stock goes up and money velocity goes up. That leads to a lot of inflation. As you see here, the money velocity peaked like around early or late 1990s and has since been really just dropping off a cliff, and it's been dropping super hard March 2020. And this gets into like macroeconomics, which most smart people will tell you don't waste your time trying to predict what's going to happen with the macro. But it is something, I don't know, maybe it's foolish, but I keep my eye on it. I think that's the whole thing with the macro, is like it's alluring. You want to figure it out, but people always say you can't figure this stuff out. The reason that the money velocity has been dropping so much, number one is technological innovation, and number two is wealth inequality. So the more money the rich people have, the more it sits in a bank account and it doesn't move around throughout society. The more the money is evenly distributed, the more the velocity goes up. So my anticipation here, sort of what I see happening in the near to midterm future, we directly give more money to poor people, helicopter money style, just direct deposits into their bank accounts. That's going to rapidly increase the money velocity, which will lead towards some level of inflation. If you listen to the Federal Reserve, they say that we're actually more nervous about deflation. It's hard to really know what to make of all this. So the prevailing narrative for why we're going to end up with deflation, both of these are bad. So there's definitely going to be one extreme, in my opinion, over the next 10 to 20 years, either a lot of inflation or a lot of deflation. The deflationary case is technological innovation leads to deflation. If you think about like 100 units of computing power in 1990 might have cost you $1 million. Those same 100 units in 2020 cost you like 1 cent. That's deflationary, technological innovation. And it's basically, I think that's why the modern monetary theory, all of this money printing, hasn't had too terrible. It's actually had really positive effects on the economy in the last 12 years, is because they're benefiting from technological deflation while they're inflating the currency. And it's just finding this happy medium, which is actually really working out well. I think that's coming to a tipping point here soon. So my anticipation and how I'm positioning myself is I don't want fiat currency. I don't want a bank account full of money. I want the minimal amount of US dollars I need to get by. And I want the rest of it in cash producing assets, or just even inflationary hedges like gold, like Bitcoin. Like, those aren't cash producing assets. Those are just not dollars. They'll appreciate relative to dollars. And then one other thing I'm keeping my eye on, this is ARK Innovation ETF. It is essentially a meme at this point, and it's an ETF that consists of what I would consider to be the consensus picks for the next decade. So the holdings of this is like CrowdStrike, it's Tesla, it's Peloton, you know, it's all the things that you think are going to grow over the next decade with no real thought about valuation. So like, just because Tesla is going to grow for the next 10 years, in all likelihood, is it worth $700 billion today? That's sort of the dynamic. I would say no. A lot of people would say yes. So these people are saying yes. And as you can see, the ETF, you know, from a low in March of what, $33, it's up to one. It peaked at about 150. We're seeing a little bit of a downturn. But to me, this is a big sentiment indicator. When this starts dropping, my thinking is with a lot of these story stocks like CrowdStrike, Teladoc, you know, Trade Desk, all of these type of things, they have really good businesses, but the multiple, you're paying like 50 to 100 times sales to own them. I think the people owning these stocks in high amounts have weak hands in general. They haven't been tested before. So when your Tesla stock, maybe not Tesla because you've made so much on it already, But when your CrowdStrike stock takes an 80% dip, do you have the hands to just hold on to that, or are you going to sell at the bottom? I think there could be sort of a doom loop that hits when these stocks start trending downward. That's one thing I'm paying attention to. Just like the shareholder base of the stocks you own. What is the general makeup of the shareholder base? Is it a handful of really thoughtful funds that have been through multiple market cycles that, you know, kind of know their stuff? Or is it a bunch of Wall Street Bets kids? You know, like it's something to pay attention to for sure. And then one last thing, I guess we can just end on this. This is the S&P 500. We're really peaking out here. It's, you know, it's all-time highs. I've read and I like this theory where you'll see the drawdowns are really short nowadays, right? Like this was the quickest 30% drop in market history in March this year with the coronavirus. And immediately it became understood the government was there. The government was going to backstop all of these companies and the economy in general. And we really quickly rose out of that. So that's part of it. And then also there's, I think, a little bit of market psychology at play here where people now understand and looking back retroactively right here, this like 2009 period where it was more of a prolonged drawdown and, you know, the pain just never ended. Like people bought the dip, then they bought this dip, then they bought this dip. And then they're like, oh, we're out of it. But then it's more pain, you know, then you buy this dip and then it's even more pain. So you're like, is it ever going to end? And we haven't experienced that in a really, really long time where you're just buying dip after dip and it keeps going down. And the two schools of thought on this is based on these past experiences, 2000 and 2008, everyone kind of understands now these huge drawdowns are generational buying opportunities. So it doesn't matter which dip you buy. Do you buy this one? Do you buy this one? This one? All of these are fine. It doesn't matter in the long run if you have a long enough timeline. Same with 2009. So that's one theory on why the dips are so much more shallow these days. So it's like, Once you get down 20%, it's just like these are generational buying opportunities. Buy whatever. It doesn't matter. It's going to go up. And I think that's it seems like a good theory on why the dips are so much shorter now. They're not protracted the way they used to be. That sort of makes me think the next dip, the next time we get this 30% drawdown, it's going to be more of the old school long drawn out one. But, you know, who really knows? It's the way to really play these things is just buy good companies that have fundamental value that don't really fluctuate too much with the market. Obviously, the market dictates what people are willing to pay for your stocks and your companies you own, but it doesn't dictate the value of them, like the absolute, the intrinsic value over the long term. While it is hard, I think, you know, what all the great investors say is the right way to approach it is just invest on a company-to-company basis, ignore the macro. So yeah, just to wrap up, guys, kind of my thoughts on things is it's really tough for me to put a lot of money to work in the current market conditions. I'm not like actively buying. I'm definitely not buying like tech stocks right now. I'm looking for value stocks, but even those, it's tough for me to put a lot of money to work right now just because of where the market is relative to the economy. I think there's a lot of things on the horizon that I kind of want to see play out. Like the eviction moratorium being lifted. What happens when that? I think March is when that happens. Basically where you're allowed to evict your tenants. The foreclosure moratorium. I just want to see some of those play out before I really, you know, put a lot of money to work. You're paid for the unknown. So the more information you have, the more everyone can accurately predict where we're headed. So if you have a take on what's going to happen, then it's probably good to, you know, express your view through some kind of ownership in a stock or non-ownership. That's sort of where my mind is at right now, guys. I'm going to do a video on the state of the cryptocurrency market too, which I do have some more stronger takes on that. But yeah, to summarize, just not really excited about investing in the stock market at the current price levels. Let me know what you guys think. Comment down below. Thanks for watching.